All right. Well, hello everyone who's tuned in. I appreciate you being with us. We are having, as you may have heard in a previous episode of Dreadnought Dominion, we're having technical difficulties tonight. Just so you guys know, Hurricane Sally is hitting or coming up the Gulf, and Ashley Armstrong, who would normally be the host, has lost at least her internet connection. I don't know if she's lost power, but they have asked me to step in and be the host. And this, guys, is going to be an adventure. So so we certainly appreciate you being with us. Have a couple of announcements to make at the end, but I thought maybe we'd just get rocking and rolling. We have a really exciting show for you tonight. With five members of Dreadnought Dominion. And actually to try to kick things off, and I say try, because, you know, you never know. All right, hang on a second. Let's see if we can do it. So I am going to share my screen. Where are we? I am going to share my screen. And I am going to play you a video from Dreadnought Dominion.
May I? I wouldn't dare try to stop you, sir.
Why don't I do us all a favor and end your little reign of incompetence now?
Setting coordinates for certain death, sir.
Off the record, I never doubted you, Sam.
Thank you, Admiral. To the Dominion.
Benson.
Has he made a decision yet?
No, I don't think so. We'll talk later.
Commander.
Benson out. That was awkward.
Roselli.
Commander. I mean, Captain. Are you ready to be picked up?
Would you like for me to kill him, sir?
No. He could be useful to me yet.
Would you like for me to kill him, sir?
Here's to you, folks.
Oh my, this really has gone too far, hasn't it?
Deck 7, bridge acknowledged.
Is that something you hear every day? A silent acknowledgement?
Live from beautiful downtown Kingsland, Georgia, right here at Stage 9 Studios, it's Dreadnought Dominion.
No, no, no. This goes there. That goes there. Got it?
Losing his structural integrity. Emergency bulkheads are closing.
Here they come.
Provoked her after she told us to leave. I was there with you, you know.
And me.
Yeah, and her.
Security cameras. Amateurs.
Their tech is lagging a bit on this planet. I expect he thinks it's enough. How should we handle this?
Like this.
Where's your other little friend?
Here I am.
I like the way they talk.
Very fun.
You find me amusing? You think I'm a clown? I'm here to amuse you?
And what did you do?
You talking to me? You talking to me? Must be. I'm the only one here.
They are defenseless against you.
And suddenly, I'm reminded of my Charlemagne. Let my armies be the rocks, and the trees, and the birds in the sky.
Thank you.
I have a bad feeling about this.
Guys, the air's fine. It's a little thin.
Deck 9. Lieutenant.
Astro.
Wayne?
Yeah.
Where are you? You'll never be able to come back, will you?
No, Astro.
I am Captain Kataka of the warship Mok Tai's Hammer. We hail from the planet Vincentia 5.
Captain, I activated the anti-grav device, but it immediately deactivated.
Why does this pathetic little moon deserve your protection? Our scans show nothing of any particular value.
I volunteer.
No, we'll find another way.
We've only got seconds, Captain.
Okay, Bridge.
So about that. Godspeed. Good luck to you all. We are many.
We are one.
Yeah, maybe that got us back. All right. Oh, my goodness. Well, you can see that I am not the technical person that I profess to be. So sorry to keep you guys waiting. By the way, I'm told that if there was any sound quality issues coming over Facebook, this video, which is DD Anthology, Dreadnought Dominion Anthology, is going to be on YouTube following the broadcast. So let's get going. I want to introduce our guests, and we have a very well-rounded group tonight. First, let me introduce you to Gary Davis.
Hello, Ray. Glad to be here tonight.
Hello, Gary. Glad to have you. Sorry that you've grown a beard since we started this.
Enjoyable.
Thank you. Let me also introduce you to Randy Wrenn.
Hello. I'm the most rounded of the group.
Okay, Randy. I got it. Then I'm going to introduce Gary Davis.
It's me again.
Oh, no, not Gary Davis. I'm going to introduce Larry Fleming.
Hello, everybody. And I told my bird that this might be a cheap broadcast, so he's talking behind me.
Well, we'll say hi for us. And then we also have Dan Scanlan.
Hello, folks.
You can see Dan is a man of few words. And we also have Victoria Avalon.
Hi, Ray. I know most people seem to think that I have a British accent in real life, but I actually don't.
Well, I never thought that, especially since you got me to the Waffle House. And you guys watching might recognize Dan and Larry as our co-hosts when we do these events. So they're playing double duty tonight, and they're certainly involved in Dreadnought. So let's get started. I'm going to turn this over to the crowd, but, you know, maybe starting with Gary, just tell us a little bit of your backstory of Dreadnought. Who came up with the idea, and when did you start?
Sure. Wow. It was back in 2014. You know, I got a message from Frank Parker, who's actually the creator of Dreadnought Dominion. And he wanted to know if I had any stories that he could turn into a new idea for a show, and if I'd be interested in coming down and being his first officer. So we turned my story over to Randy Wrenn, who took a short story and turned it into a fabulous script. And we went down and shot our first episode, which was Anchors Away. and directed by Mike Bednar. And then we came back, what, like 2 months later in January, where it was really cold, and we shot Haunted. And we put those together for our first episode. And after that, we all just got the acting bug and the making Star Trek bug. And we just kept coming back over the years. So here it is, 2020. And, you know, we just filmed our latest episode and it's in post and should be out in the coming weeks.
Anyone else want to add to that?
Well, the last piece of video you saw was the episode that is in post-production and possibly one of the most ambitious ones we've done, with lots of sets used and lots of intriguing non-technical difficulties. I saw it and it looks amazing.
Excellent. Excellent. And I'm sure we're all waiting for it. I have no doubt that you've got the VFX guys working overtime, Gary. I've already heard that from them.
Oh, definitely. Matter of fact, we, Randy and I were watching some renders pop up on our computers, and Randy drops them into the timeline immediately. And, you know, we both get excited. It's like Christmas when we open up our emails.
That's great. I understand the excitement. So that's great. And you guys have been doing this a long time, but, so maybe we could go around, I don't want to say around the room, but I guess it's around the room. And maybe you guys could tell us a little bit about yourselves. Who do you play? How did you get involved? And you could even tell us, if you like, what your day job is. Let's start with Gary. You want to start?
Oh, sure. Well, I'm retired Navy administration. And, you know, now I work for a wholesale furniture company. And I started off on the show as the executive officer. And when Frank Parker stepped aside and took a break, then we needed a captain. So what other answer could I give? But definitely I'll sit in the center seat. So I became the captain of the show. And with my cohort, Randy Wrenn, who's my partner in crime, production partner, better half, the guy that just makes everything sing. He makes it look easy, and it's just great doing this stuff. And then, you know, we had some just talented people just drop in. I just can't thank them enough. And we've got, you know, four other people here who just make Dreadnought Dominion the success, in my opinion, that it is.
Terrific. Randy, do you want to chime in?
Sure. I was going to school at a community college in 2013, and I heard this voice from across the room. I didn't know who it was, never met him. And I heard Star Trek, Star Trek, Star Trek, Star Trek, Star Trek, Star Trek. And I wandered over and introduced myself, and it was Frank Parker Jr. He says, yeah, we're building sets down in Kingsland. Showed me pictures, said, you want to come down and help us build them? So I went down for a couple of weekends. Second weekend, on the way home, he said, you know, I've got this story that we're going to turn into a script and we're going to shoot it. It's called Who Haunts This Ship? It's by Gary Davis. He said, could you turn it into a script? And I said, sure, because I'm not smart enough to realize I don't know how to do that. So I, yeah, sure, why not? And so I did the script and we shot it. And then we, you know, we also did Anchors Away. While we were waiting for those to go through post-production, which to us seemed like forever because, you know, we didn't know, we geared up and did, started an audio series called Star Trek Outlaws. We've done four episodes of that over the years. And then we lost the studio because of, you know, Star Trek Continues. And while we didn't have a studio, Frank, Gary, and Vance Major just started doing these things in their living rooms and such. We did a couple of those. Then we came back to the sets. And meanwhile, I just got the bug, you know, to make films. And I started a series called What Lies Beyond, which is not mostly not science fiction and never anything to do with Star Trek, but it's there and we've got it. We've got four episodes of that. And then this latest episode, we're so excited about it because it's like Dan said, it's very ambitious. It's very dramatic. It's got our first on-screen kiss. Very excited about that. And our first on-screen red shirt demise. And we got to shoot on an amazing green screen, which Gary can tell you about, or Dan, or anybody that was there. Victoria was there. So I'll shut up and let somebody else talk.
All right. That was actually very interesting. Dan, do you want to go?
Well, I got lucky. We're doing some version with another series, and I assisted doing audio with the first Dreadnought Dominion, hanging off a ladder for the bar scene. And then from there, I became Commander Don, and even briefly had some fun the last episode. But I was the puny weakling that was held captive by the Romulans and being back in the last episode. The day job, a reporter. My fantasy job is hanging out with this gang. Victoria and I worked together on Starship Farragut. I've been with Ray and at the studio for 10 years. All these guys here have helped build something there. And now we're producing all these fun things. And I'm serious. Wait till you see the next Dreadnought Dominion.
Excellent. Excellent. I think, Dan, you're having some your own technical difficulties because we could hear you, but you weren't moving.
Well, we have a thunderstorm right now, right over me. So I wouldn't be surprised because I'm looking at myself here, haven't moved an inch.
Okay. Larry, you've got an impending storm as well, but let's get you in hopefully for the rest of the night.
Well, I think we're okay right now. The storm is quickly approaching, but this is a fun group. I've been fortunate enough to be on a number of different Star Trek crews for fan films. And I can tell you, I really have a blast with these guys. There's humor in these films, like the original Star Trek had. I mean, so you get to watch and there's drama, but they lighten it up with humor and I get to be part of that. I've been involved in the sets from the beginning, but I didn't really know what they were doing until we got it back. Star Trek Continues did a great job with all their work, but they kept the studios to themselves. And so when they finally got it back, when Ray was able to pick it up and get it back, everybody's flocked in with their videos and I was able to help out, including one of my own, and I'm writing another one. So fans of Star Trek cannot get enough.
Terrific, terrific. Victoria, what's your story?
I don't think it's anything really that special. I'm an attorney and in Central Florida, and I'm with Dan Scanlan, one of the original builders of the Neutral Zone sets. I joined the Farragut Films Collective in 2012, right after they'd moved from St. Mary's, and Dan's actually been with or had been with Farragut longer than I was. When I showed up, they had just finished putting the bridge back together. So that tells you how early I was involved. I was with Farragut and appeared in three of their productions. The last one is in post-production. I'm a background character, the transporter operator. I was largely film crew in those. And that lasted until about 2015 when that effort folded. After that, I got involved with Randy Landers and of Project Potemkin fame. And I've played the role of Shan Gabriel in his Demos production since 2015. In various vignettes on and off, and my character is the captain of the ship now, and that's very fascinating. I enjoy that a great deal. Randy's fantastic to work with. I met Randy Wrenn and Gary Davis through Frank Parker who was a longtime friend of my husband. My husband used to put on filk conventions in the Northeast, and that's how he knew Frank. And I met the Dominion crew through their filming of their first two episodes on sets. I helped with filming one of them. About 2017, Gary reached out to me. He was putting together his Excalibur Logs production, which is fantastic, and people ought to see it. It's virtually entirely animated. And he pulled together a lot of women from various fan films. Some of us are from Farragut and others from other productions, and had us all play the voices of the Excalibur crew. And that's where I first played the character I play on Dreadnought Dominion, Dr. Maureen Farrell. That turned out very well. And when they were getting ready to film Redemption at Red Medusa, they had a casting problem. The lady that was playing their doctor was not able to show up. So at very short notice, Gary reached out to me and asked if I was available that weekend, and turned out I was. And I've been in three Dominion episodes now as Dr. Farrell, including the one that's in post-production now. They're a great group of folks. There's a lot of Farragut alumni along for the ride there. It's kind of like old times, going back up there and playing in the old sandbox again and visiting the old studio and all of that. It's really been a great ride. I've enjoyed it tremendously.
Well, that was a lot more than I expected you to say, but it's all fascinating with how you guys started and then all got together, and you've been together for now a long time. And I think that's very admirable. If any of you are admirals, I think it's very admirable. Something I just want to mention, I met all of these folks probably in 2018, I'm going to guess, about 2 years ago, thereabouts. And I came out, I watched them film part of one of their episodes. Forgive me for saying it, but I think Gary and I had become pretty good friends. And Gary has built some of the sets and set pieces that you see specifically for the neutral zone. You know, not to go into the whys and wheres, but when you see people sitting in the captain's chair, you might as well see Gary sitting in the chair, because he built it. And the view screen in the captain's quarters, and our dilithium crystal chamber, all that's a product of Gary. So Gary, my hat is off to you.
Well, I was glad and honored to be able to make those pieces for you. And I love watching the different productions, and I love that my stuff is getting used, and it has a great home where your set is at. And, you know, that's what makes me honored, is it has a place that it can call home as great as the neutral zone.
Well, thanks. I really do appreciate that. And I appreciate your help, and I appreciate knowing all of you. So we watched your anthology at the beginning. How many episodes do you think you've produced, episodes, vignettes, and he's counting, so he knows. And do you have a favorite?
Well, we have 11, and I've got them up on my wall. So we have 4 major productions, and we have 7 vignettes. And, you know, and the 11 count, we are many that that were in post-production. I think, Randy, you got like 20 more already written. So we're all good to go for the next decade. Matter of fact, we are many. When we were taking a road trip back in 2016 or 2017, and Randy pitched me that idea for We Are Many, which I think the pitch lasted longer than the actual show. And he explained it in such great detail. I remember that conversation. And sure enough, when I was filming that, I was like, this seems very familiar. But it was a great pitch. It was a great episode. And Randy just has more and more. So he just comes up with these ideas. You know, I tweak lines, but I don't pretend to be the writer. I let the creative genius that is Randy Wrenn do all of that. But we've got a lot more to go.
You know, there was something that was groundbreaking when we did technical difficulties. We did it in front of a live audience, and it was done during one of our fan weekends with the Neutral Zone Studios, where people came and they sat and they watched and they applauded, and then they kept their mouths shut, bless their souls, when I would hold up the microphone and say, quiet on the set. It was great. Kudos to them for hanging out and watching us as they would watch a production get made and take two, take three, not too many. But it was also great because they stayed very late for the opening to be our audience and provide some canned applause.
It was surreal. The studio audience were just quiet as church mice when we hit go. And there wasn't any arguing with anybody. You know, they were very respectful. We had crowds on the bridge and we had a crowd in engineering. Matter of fact, I think the way the engineering set is done, we had actors in crowds like 5 feet apart. We could be social distancing and do this and be safe, but they were so quiet and we got everything on the first or second take, and it wasn't their fault. It was our fault. We screwed up the line, had to redo it. So that was an experience. I don't think it was ever done before, was it? A live studio audience for a Trek fan film? But
no, actually, I remember, I think you were talking about filming during one of our fan weekends.
Yep, that was it.
And I remember saying to you, or writing you, and saying, hey, what do you think about filming in front of a live audience? And the next thing I knew, there was a live audience. So I remember that. I that was wonderful and had a lot of fun. Randy, I think you had your hand up.
Well, I was just going to say that Ray was there when we shot that scene in engineering. And There was a whole line of people along that back wall. And I came around the corner and said, this goes there, that goes there. And, which, by the way, is a Star Wars reference.
So, Randy, let me ask you, do you have a favorite episode?
Oh, gee whiz. I don't know. I guess Red Medusa, but I think it's going to be replaced by We Are Many very shortly.
Okay. Larry?
I like every one that I've been in.
Okay. Victoria?
Of the three that I've been in, I think I like the heist the best. We hadn't even planned on me to be in that one, but they were filming the shipboard scenes when I was there when we did Red Medusa. And a lot of those lines were ad-libbed. It was really hilarious. And the line in the briefing room where I said to one of the guys when we were talking about the operation on their ears, I said, it's not going to hurt. And I looked at Gary and said, much. And everybody broke down laughing. I'll never forget that. That was hilarious. But I think that one I enjoyed the most.
Well, speaking of parodies, a couple of people have asked, and the latest one is a question from James Kyle. And it's not really a question, but it says, you know, let's talk about the Space 1999 parody, which I played earlier on social media, which I just got a hoot out of watching that.
I love doing those. You know, I love video editing. And then we didn't have shows to video edit, then I wanted to do little mixes. So I started with Space 1999. I've done Hawaii 50, and then the last one I did was Lost in Space. And those are just so much fun because I want to emulate exactly what the original creators of those shows did for those openings and then throw us in there. And there's a lot of footage that we have for all these shows that just make those easy. And I'm always looking for good suggestions to do another one. But I like to stay sci-fi, but the Hawaii 50 one was just really, really funny. That was really great. But I like the Space 99 one is one of my favorites too.
Sophia, well, you know, we've had a ton of fun. We've had a ton of fun. You want to talk parodies? To do A Barrel Full of Quincy and to have John Sims playing all the characters flawlessly. And when you see the finished edited project, it is amazing. My favorite is Red Medusa, because I had to grow a beard and let my hair go for 3 months to play the prisoner. And then I was called weak and harmless before I appeared. And then Victoria, as the doctor, comes and rushes up to me on the transporter pad and shows that she's a little old school, because she checks her old style digital watch to check my heartbeat. It just was something different for me to do. I can read a script, but this one I had to play a pretty beat up guy after 2 years in a prison camp.
I know I was there for that part of the shoot. I think that's where I met Victoria, as a matter of fact.
I got to beat you up.
Yes, you did. My idea too, silly me. I still have the bruises.
You are talking about on set, right, Larry?
Yes.
So so you mentioned before, because I think it's interesting when things get into perspective. So you started filming in 2014. I guess some of you met in 2013. And then obviously you guys were on hiatus for, 4 years, maybe more, five, with Star Trek Continues.
No, we didn't want to let this slow us down. So when we lost the sets, we looked for other sets first. And, you know, that's when we went to Oklahoma and looked at Starbase Studios. But even they were having some internal struggles, so that didn't pan out. So I just asked Randy, I go, we can make any room look like Star Trek. And that's what we did. So I worked at my wholesale furniture company, and we had a nice big conference room, and I just moved things around and I put things on the wall, and voila, we made a Starbase lounge. And Vance Major, who's a force of nature in fan films, you know, he wrote this great episode about Captain Brousseau trying to choose his first officer. And that was the first time I made a prop. I made the viewer so I could talk to him. And we produced a nice little vignette, you know, lasted, you know, 8 minutes or so, without benefit of having, you know, an amazing set to do. We just faked it. And, you know, that's what we did for the next couple of years. And then the very next year, I got a call from Vance, and he says, that script we did, you know, Command and Conquer, how would you like to flip the script and do it again in the mirror universe? And again, what actor doesn't like to play the bad guy? So I grew a beard, and because beards are always equated with the mirror universe and being bad, and, you know, slapped on the fake tattoo, and I became the mirror Brousseau, and Randy with his eye patch as his character. And we just shot the same script more or less, and we called it Command and Conquer. And that was fun. And again, sometimes you don't need great sets. You just need great imagination. And, you know, we got creative partners like Randy and Vance. You still have fun, but nothing compares to being on those sets. So when you obtained those and we were able to come back and shoot Reality Check, which that is one of my favorite episodes, tied with Reality Check and Silent Acknowledgement, because Reality Check was my homage to all the guys in the background. You know, like Royal Weaver, who opens and closes those doors, and everybody who holds a microphone, Dan, because you guys make us sound good so that we can act. But Reality Check bounced us back and forth between Star Trek and reality. And that was the most fun I'd ever had, even though it was 103 degrees in there in March. So that was a challenge. But we were honored to be the first ones to shoot on your studio after it was rechristened. It wasn't the Neutral Zone, it was Stage 9.
At the time, it was Stage 9 Studios. Yeah.
So we were just honored to be there first. And I brought the, no, I didn't bring the chair until the next time, but that was just great being there. But
I think the time that you shot there, and I remember you, I think the day I announced that I was taking over the studio, I got a message from you saying, hey, what are you doing with those studios? And when you first showed up and you first started filming in there, it was Vic's chair. Nobody could sit in Vic's chair. So I remember you doing the whole scene standing next to the chair. And I think you even said somewhere, I don't think I'd feel comfortable in it.
Yeah, I was halfway down to Georgia when I got your call saying, Gary, you can still shoot, but there's a problem. You can't sit in the chair. I said, well, but I'm the captain of the ship. So Randy, again, Randy's just brilliant. So we were brainstorming and in the hotel when I finally got to Kingsland, and I said, let's just make it where I don't want to sit down. Like, I don't deserve it yet. And so we put it in there, and I still chuckle over that part when Randy looks over and goes, are you going to sit down or what? And that's when I did the line, I don't think this belongs to me yet. I don't feel like I deserve it. So we wrote it into the script. Like I said, I love moments like that. So what we thought was going to be a disaster turned into part of the story. And I love it. I wouldn't change a moment of that one.
That's great.
You know, if I can say, working with these folks, working on Dreadnought has been some of the most enjoyable film work that I've done in 10 years. They're all a great bunch. They all know their lines. They all know where to do and what to do. And when we have little technical difficulties, we found ways around them, such as the use of the chair, which turned out to be a wonderful plot line. I don't feel like I deserve to be there. It just was wonderful and it worked like a charm. When we did the one where we showed up, the crew showed up, we would slide in the alternate reality and then slide out, and then they go back to what they were doing. And it was a blast. I got to show up just as the guy with the mic instead of a crew member, you know.
Victoria, any memories you'd like to share about your years? Because obviously I did not know that you went back as far as you went back with the studio. So are there any memories you'd like to share?
Well, there's plenty. I don't know if I've told people, or actually said publicly, very publicly, how I got involved in Farragut in the first place. They had just published, I want to say it was For Want of a Nail. And the one that they did after that was still in post-production at the time. And I'd seen it on YouTube, and at the end of it, it had in it where they filmed it at, and I realized that that was not very far from where I was living at the time. And on their website, there was an email address, and I sent an email, figuring that I might or might not hear from the people who made this, because I've been a Star Trek fan since the original Star Trek. When I was just a toddler, I used to stay up late and sneak out to watch it when it was on TV on Friday nights. And I got a response back from John Broughton, like he called me 15 minutes after I sent this email. And recruited me in to help build. And I never expected that would happen. But I owe John and the Bednars, Mike and Holly, a great debt, because I've been at this now for 8 years. And that was my entree into the world. And it's just been tremendous fun. I was crew on 2 Star Trek Continues episodes, and that was hilarious. I've got to watch Vic Mignogna and Chris Duhon running lines. I was setting up a mesh flag when they were doing Pilgrim of Eternity, and you couldn't see the actors, but you could hear the voices. and as I'm setting up this mesh flag for Matt Busey, and it was like being transported back to 1969. It was so cool. It was so cool because they're both very good. Vic has always had the mannerisms down. I mean, and he's not a parody. He's just on. And of course, Chris sounds just like his father. And he's one of the nicest guys you'll ever meet. Between Sam Rooks and Matt Busey, they taught me so much about the science and the art of lighting things and making film. It's just been a tremendous ride. I went from that to working with Randy Landers, and from that to working with the Dreadnought Dominion crew. And I haven't had a bad experience yet. I'm just very fortunate.
That's terrific. And I kind of made a little bit of a joke at the beginning when I introduced you, Victoria, about introducing me to the Waffle House. But I remember you telling me that one of the things that was one of your favorite memories was after filming, you guys would all go to the Waffle House.
Well, it was actually before, and there is a Waffle House and there's a story connected to that. There's a story connected to everything. I'll do this real quick. There's a Waffle House in Kingsland, just like there is everywhere else. And one of the two managers of construction, a fellow named Greg Green, used to have breakfast there every morning, and we'd all go meet Greg in the morning. And that became a thing. He was associated with that. So I kind of associate fan films with that. And I kind of have a tradition now that when I go on a shoot, the last thing I do when I'm packing up to go home after the shoot's over, the day I leave, I have breakfast at the closest Waffle House to remember all my friends that I've made, because that's really what this is about and has been about for me. Are the people that I meet, and the relationships, and the friends that I have met. It has enriched my life tremendously.
Nice memories, good memories. I'm going to go over to Larry for a second, because we were all kind of talking, Larry, about what we do as a day job, and you didn't really talk about that. But I think people would be interested who don't know what you sort of do these days and what you've done in the past.
Okay. Many, many years ago, when I became a Star Trek fan, I wanted to go into space. And when I found out that they didn't have transporters, and I had to go in one of those little tiny capsules, I decided to work in aerospace in communications. So I worked on a satellite project. We've got 16 satellites up there now that I helped put up there, working at TRW Aerospace. So that's what I did for my day job for many years. And when I retired from that, I started getting back into what I really wanted to do, and that was working in film. So I started producing films. And that's kind of how I ran across all the Star Trek fan films. I was looking around for something to get in and support, and Farragut had The Crossing up. And I saw that, and I immediately started contributing to it and became a fan of what they were doing. And they let me come to the set and have a walk-on part. And I was hooked. The sets are beautiful. I tell people all the time, when you walk on those sets, if you don't look up, you think you're on the Enterprise or pick your starship. It doesn't matter. You think you're there. And as a fan, I will work in any episode in any role that anybody has just to be on that set. Like was said, I mean, for a little while we didn't have access to it. So I've also worked out of Oklahoma, worked on a couple of films there that they had. I also work with Randy over in Alabama on his sets, and he's now up in Kentucky, and I should be up there next month filming something. I just love doing this, and the fans are the nicest people you're going to ever meet. I started doing some local work here in the Georgia area because we have a lot of films being filmed here before COVID. And I've been in, 150 films here, different films and TV shows. And these guys are so professional, you can't have fun on a set. But for these Star Trek fan films, we have fun on the set. I mean, we're not wasting time. We got a short amount of time, but we're having a blast doing it. And I will continue to do this. I'm probably going to retire from the other stuff and just only do fan films because I love it so much.
And something you didn't mention is some of the other work you do out of Atlanta or the Atlanta area and some of the shows and movies you've been background in.
Well, I was a savior on The Walking Dead. Got some good screen time in season 8. I was a walker up through season 3, and I didn't like all the makeup in the chair and stuff, so I stopped doing that. I've been in pretty much every Marvel film filmed in Atlanta. I've got screen time in Endgame that just came out, the biggest grossing film so far. And if we don't get back to making films, it's going to be the biggest grossing film ever. They're right now working on one that I was in called Red Notice with The Rock and Ryan Reynolds. I got some good screen time on that. They're trying to finish it now. I've just had a blast. I've been able to work with the greatest directors, but they're very professional sets and you can't goof off unless you're a big actor. So fan films are the way to go if you want to have fun.
That's interesting. I guess, Gary, you're probably the proponent of that, right?
We try. We keep it lighthearted, and we don't do a lot of cut up because, we want to get in. We want to get it on film. We want to get it right, but we still have fun. And nothing I like about the energy on Dreadnought Dominion is, we have directors, and sometimes we have 3 or 4 directors, and then we also listen to everybody on set, which is my favorite part, because I'm focused here and here and here, and I'm looking at this, and somebody goes, "I have a suggestion," and we let it rip, and and that's the best part for me, is we direct with the collective sort of sorts, and then we have drop-ins, people that we didn't even plan on being there, who just show up, and then they're part of the integral part of the show. And then we have folks like Dan and Victoria and Larry, who I invited to come in, and they just became lovable characters. One of my favorite memories is with Victoria, because we did a scene in the captain's quarters for Red Medusa. I think it was the end of the day. I was dead tired from doing it. And Victoria came in with this energy, and she just hit me with that Southern character of hers. And I guess that's where you get the expression, you drew the performance out of somebody, and she just drew that out. So I'm dead tired, and Randy came up and just said, "That was pretty good, Gary." And I go, "It's all Victoria who did that." So, that's the kind of stuff that I enjoy on the set. And that's how it keeps lighthearted, is all the people. And Dan with his jokes and his comments, and that's what she said type stuff. He's just the biggest cut up, and you got to be careful what you say around Dan, because he just makes it a comedy act, and I wouldn't trade 1 minute of it.
Well, it's funny you should say slap, Gary, because that's the next episode's best scene, I think.
Yeah, the captain gets slapped, and I talked about story pitching, and Randy pitched me that idea a long time ago. He just says, "I can't wait to watch you get slapped." But
how many times?
It's like 9 times I got slapped.
And we had a tough time keeping it straight and not laughing, and so did you guys, but we got it done in, 10 minutes? And we got some great takes. So, again, professionalism, while we still had a lot of fun.
But what I love about Randy's heart is that even though he was giddy about watching me get slapped, he told the actress, "You have to slap me before you slap Gary, so I get to feel what it's like." So even him being cruel and wanting to torture the captain, he was going to feel it first. So I always appreciate him.
Yeah, I got the actress aside and I said, "Look, just to make sure we got the intensity of this slap right,
I said, just slap me, just real easy. She's, you know, no, harder than that. A little bit harder. Right there, that's it. Now, just do that.
Well, you know, having done several fan films and seeing you guys do fan films, you guys have a built-in rapport because you know each other for so long. But in my personal case, I usually start with maybe some folks that I know, Dan certainly, and Larry are there. But I usually have another cast playing a different crew on a different ship. But the first thing you do is you build a rapport. You get in front, you know, and you get in front of them and you just start making jokes and you just want them to understand that, look, you know, we're not up for an Emmy, okay, but we want to make something that's good, but we want to have fun in the process. So I certainly appreciate what you guys do and how well you do it together.
So yeah, a few minutes ago, Gary mentioned the scene with him and Victoria in the captain's cabin. And I had just been sitting here thinking, what is my all-time favorite scene that we've done? And I think that would be it. With Victoria fussing at the captain about him needing to come down for a physical, and then him being frustrated because he couldn't figure out what happened to the ship years before. We've done some really exciting things that I'm really happy about. Shooting on that amazing green screen down there, and I can't remember the name of the school or anything. Gary can fill you in with the details, but that was one of my most memorable experiences, is shooting on that green screen. But I think one of my favorite scenes was that with Victoria and Gary in the captain's cabin.
Well, you know, by the way, the next time you need a green screen, I found a green screen studio in St. Mary's, and it's just very professionally laid out and well done. Even has one half of it as a green screen and the other half is set up as a theater. So it's kind of cool. So at some point, I'm sure we'll all get back together. I have a question on Facebook for Gary, and it's from John Black, who we all know. And John wants to know, it's probably a little self-serving, but John wants to know, is that the Dreadnought photo I sent you on the shelf behind you, Gary?
It is. Where did it go? I can't see it. I don't have my glasses on.
Do you have cap?
Yeah. He sent me a photo of the HMS Dreadnought. And matter of fact, I even bought a model for that too. But it's a great old photo of the HMS Dreadnought. And HMS Dominion. And I plan on using that on the set in the future, along with the model that I brought. So yes, thank you so much for that gift. I appreciated it.
So I know, you know, COVID has put a hold on just about everything. And I know for folks like us, it's sometimes a little difficult to even travel. Let alone, you know, try to spend some time and make a movie or an episode. But do you guys, you know, what do you think the future holds for you guys?
Well, I guess I'll take this real quick. We've got more Dreadnought Dominion coming, of course. You know, we've got a script that I'm really excited about because it involves our series creator, Frank Parker. So Frank Parker will be reprising his role as Commodore Grissom. Now that's our next planned shoot. So the next time we can come down to Kingsland, that's where we're doing that. And you know that story, I don't want to give too much away, but it's kind of going to be like a reverse It's a Wonderful Life, where we get to see what would have happened if Commodore Grissom hadn't left the Dominion. And then Dreadnought Dominion's also going to have not one, but two spinoffs. So we're going to have two spinoff series. One is going to take place up here in Columbus, where I am making a TOS runabout set where we can have self-contained little stories on our ship and our small runabout, which will have a crew of four and can go visit different places. And then Frank Parker, the creator of Dreadnought Dominion, is also planning a spinoff of his own. He's going to make some sets in Gastonia. So Dreadnought Dominion is going to be joined by two sister productions. So we're really excited about both endeavors.
That's great. That's absolutely great. And you know what? It's good that you guys are all a family. Happy to present, you know, something like this where, you know, we don't get to see you all that much anymore, except in the reruns, as they would say. I've had a blast watching your work. There's no doubt about it. I'm seeing a lot of remarks online talking about, you know, different episodes you've shot and the vignettes you've shot. So you've got a great following. Is there anything that you guys just want to say as, I don't want to say parting remarks, but is there anything that you want to talk about specifically that we haven't?
I think simply put, this is the right group of people to present a new Star Trek story with heart, soul, and humor and intelligence. As I'm looking at the screen here and the people that I have, who I've worked with, I've never had as much fun. If this is what a fan film is, let's make sure every fan film is like this, period.
Well said, Dan. Well said. I know you sent me a message. I know there was a runabout. You don't want to play that. Okay. Sorry, guys, we're not going to play that. You'll have to wait for it in the video. I want to thank you guys. I'm going to say something here. First of all, these are the kind of folks that make you want to keep the studio going. I pitch it every chance I get. There's a cost associated with it. Most of you know that, we don't charge any admission fee when we have these fan weekends. The guys who come to film, I hopefully think just pay a nominal fee for the use of the sets. But we want to make it available to everyone. So, we can always use help. We always are looking for donations. You can go to our website, neutralzonestudios.com, and click on the support us link. And that'll help us, as I say, keep the lights on. And we want these guys to come back. Brings up a completely different question. I don't know who this one is aimed at. So you guys have been doing this, and I know that you stayed together and did several things on your own, but you've been doing this for quite a number of years. Certainly before the CBS guidelines came out. And I hate to say that, but certainly before the guidelines came out. And yet you've managed to keep the same ship, the same crew, the same actors. What do you attribute to that, if I could ask it maybe that way?
I think it's the energy and the positive feelings of that we just bring out. And then, we have lost people, some people just can't come back and participate, but that's what makes this so great is we have those drop-ins and then we have those invitees like Victoria and Larry, we invited them to become part of our family. And I was honored when both of them agreed to come aboard. It was them doing me the favor or us the favor. Randy and I both invited them, but I think that's what keeps us together. Is the the positive energy and hey, let's just go out and have like Dan says, let's just go out and have some fun and do some making of Star Trek.
And Gary, when I went up to to Randy's neighborhood to shoot the exteriors for the heist. And it was a whole brand new experience for me. I'm in my 60s and I'm still learning and loving doing films. And that was wonderful. And we had to worry about things we didn't have to worry about in a studio. Like, hey guys, we got to get outside because the sun is setting, or we've got noise down the hallway at the facility we're in, and my audio is gonna, well, guess what? My audio wasn't because we knew how to work on it. And then Randy brings in these wonderful actors that he and I had worked with on one of his other non-Trek films. So it was great to see them and watch them do their thing. And then this weekend, there was a film festival where one of the Dreadnought Dominions was shown. And there are some of the same actors I worked with there and on Dominion in two of the episodes. So it's a small world down here in the Southeast, but it's great to work with people who know what they're doing, but don't necessarily want money. You know, they just want to do the acting and they want to do it right.
Yeah, Randy has this knack of finding people who want to be part of a Star Trek fan film. And they are, I call them professional actors. You know, in the last couple episodes, I'm doing scenes with these professional actors. You know, I felt like a seven in a Miss America pageant. I'd use that joke over and over again. But Randy has this talent for finding these people. I want to know how he does it. And they come down without being paid. They pay their own hotels and they just bring it. You know, the only small part that I can do is I'm the costumer. So I give them their costume. That's their payment for being part of this. And I enjoy the look on their face when they go, I get to keep this. And it's a little self-serving, but I love the feeling when I give that stuff away. And again, that's part of why I think the people keep coming back. Oh yeah, I love doing t-shirts. I'm a t-shirt nut. So I've got several Dominion t-shirts and they're just fun to do. But Randy, again, thank you, Randy.
Yeah, the costumes that you give them, and also it's fun to watch their expressions when they come onto the sets for the first time. Rachel Petsiavas, the beautiful lady that's the long brunette hair. Tracy Lords. No?
I think Tracy Lords, you're dating yourself now.
What, Tracy, I thought her name was Lord. The lady was, you know her name, Gary? Go ahead. Anyway, and Art Parcells, they were in the heist. They were in Red Medusa to some extent, and we were filming the heist, and I needed a break. I had to run do something, and I didn't want production to stop. So I turned to Art Parcells and I said, "Can you take it from here?" And he directed a couple of scenes while I was gone. I don't know if he's ever directed anything in his life. And then at the studio down there, I guess I'm the primary director because, you know, Gary's busy acting and I'm not in, he's in just like every scene pretty much. And I'm not. So I take the directing chores, but he always directs, Tracy. And then, Tracy Frank is her name. He always directs Tracy, his wife. And also, if I need a break, I said, Gary, you got it for a few minutes? And he just takes over and we go back and forth.
You know,
and let's not forget that Larry has been our lensman for many, many of our recent shoots. Larry Fleming has run the camera and found the shots.
Absolutely, absolutely. You know, one of the things that you sort of touched on a little bit that I think people probably would have no clue about is, you know, the studio's in a really an old aluminum building. There's no air conditioning, so it's hot in the summer, it's cold in the winter. But we also have other businesses and companies around us. So you might be in the middle of filming a scene and they start digging rocks at the stone quarry about 100 feet away. And what do? You can't go outside and tell them to stop digging stones because we're filming. Would they really care? No. So you have to take a break and, you know, go buy food and wait till they stop digging.
Or you end up ADRing all the dialogue. We'll get it in post, Randy.
Yeah, the barking dog and the railroad trains. Yes, those are, as the guy with the mic, the boom mic, those are my nightmares. And there's four railroad crossings, so that means the train is honking its horn four times over 20 minutes, and you might as well go grab a slice of pizza because it's going to be 20 minutes.
Yeah, we made light of all the noise in Reality Check. You know, one of our first productions there for Haunted, there was a motorcycle that we had to stop for. So in Reality Check, we wrote into the story, you have to stop, there's a motorcycle going by. So, you know, most of Reality Check was inside jokes of our filming, and, you know, the studio noise was part of the story.
Oh yeah, and the bit where we stopped and we on our marks and looked down at our marks, and the, who was playing the director? It wasn't one of us, but somebody else was playing the director in Reality Check. And they, stop looking at your marks.
You know, one of the other things that people should probably know, and I'm not sure who said it, but one of you said it, is, I think, Randy, you said it, is the look on people's faces when they see the studio for the first time. And I was invited by Vic to come see the studio after they had finished. I didn't even know they were filming Continues in Kingsland. I had no idea. And that's another story, but I had gone to see the studio for the first time, and they stood me in front of the doors that open into the corridor. And Royal said to me something that I say to everybody now who comes and stands in front of those doors: when these doors open, you're going to find yourself the age you were when you first fell in love with Star Trek. And that's about as true a statement as I've ever heard. So there you go. So there you go.
The actors that I invite, find and invite down, are very, very good actors, by the way. We don't deserve to have them in our show. but they come, and because they're nice people and they like me, I guess. But they come, and then as soon as they get there, they don't say the words, but I get the feeling that they're like, oh, well, this is what it is. Now I'm glad I came. Yeah.
Well, I did it for a person who I invited. You guys may or may not know Kavita Maharaj, who does Retrospect Studios, and she's the artist that does the Spock paintings, which are beautiful. And I invited her to come see the studio, and we lit it for her before we opened for the weekend. And we opened the doors, and all she did was cry. It's those type of things that say, this is why we're here. So, you know, you may not think you deserve to have those people that are working on set, but those people are having a ball, and they probably, if they haven't thanked you enough for allowing them to be a part of it, then they should, because I understand what that's all about.
Well, let me say thank you to the folks who have to drive the furthest. Victoria has, what, 6 hours, 7 hours to get there. Ray, you got a 5 or 6 hour trip. And then look at Randy and Gary, who have to come from way north of us. For those of us who live an hour or so away and call the Neutral Zone studio somewhat local, we're lucky. I can go home at the end of a shoot and sleep, and you guys have to pay for a room. So my credit to all of you who get in your car, make the long mileage to get there, have had some incidents with blown tires, etc., and still managed to make it. Heck, we had a videographer whose trailer flipped and all his gear was in it once, not for a Dreadnought, but something else. And so it's just amazing what we do for what we love to do.
I'm 12 hours from the studio, but I make that drive happily. And a shout out to my missus, my wife Tracy, who was never a Star Trek fan before she met me, and now she's acting in a Star Trek fan film. And I don't know if anybody knows that my wife is deaf, And she was in a few of our shows in the beginning where we gave her small lines that she could actually pronounce. And then one time I just decided to go the complete opposite direction. I made her character deaf so she could sign, because, you know, after being married to her for so long, sign language is such a beautiful language. So I got to say thank you to my wife for bringing that performance. Like I said, she's not a Star Trek fan, and now she can sign her lines, and we have Randy's daughter do the voice for the Universal Translator. And Tracy can actually act because she's signing now. And, you know, sign language is very expressive with the face and the eyes and the hands. So, you know, I direct Tracy, but there's very little direction I need to do for her because it's just her talking. And I think when we film Tracy's scenes, Dan especially appreciates this. We don't need any sound, so everybody can be as noisy as they want when we shoot her stuff. But again, I thank my spouse for putting up with her crazy husband and traveling 12 hours to be on a hot or a cold set in a mini skirt where she's afraid to show her rear end. So she's awesome.
Well, give her a hug for me. I could only get 6 feet from her if I was there, but give her a hug for me, because I don't know. She's a lovelier person I don't know that I've ever met. She's always comes up to me with a smile and a hug. And you know what? That's good. That's worth the price of admission.
Definitely. Definitely.
Larry, any parting words there?
I just want to throw a couple things in here. Talking about Tracy's role, we were at a convention and there were some people in the line waiting to get into the chair that you were setting up for everybody. And this one girl came up and I saw that she was signing. So I pulled silent acknowledgement up on my phone and I walked over and I showed it to her, and she started crying because it was for her. And of course she had to get the link and everything, and it was just really appreciated. And that's just one side story that I wanted to tell. The other thing I wanted to mention, I did drop a note in here. Gary's chair is great, and it's had some guest butts in it. Nichelle Nichols has sat in that chair, you know, so, you know, along with Vic and everybody else from STC and stuff. But I mean, Nichelle Nichols has sat in that chair. So if we get to sit in the chair, or when Gary gets to be captain again, he's sitting in the chair that she sat in.
That's right. You can call it butt acknowledgement or something. Randy, I want to see that as your next episode.
You got it.
Victoria, anything you'd like to end with?
Just briefly, this didn't have to do with Dominion, which I'm surprised that it hasn't, because I know that our series has reached out and touched so many people. And I didn't realize that these films that we make do. I had no idea. When I was playing on Farragut, I played a background character. I played the transporter chief, and Holly Bednar had asked me to do a French accent, which I worked for quite some time to cultivate, to learn how to do. And years after that ended, in 2015, I went to Trek-lanta, which is really, it's really the only Trek convention I've ever been to, was that one in 2015. I don't do conventions as a rule, but someone stopped me, recognized me from Conspiracy of Innocence, and asked me a question in French. And I mean, I was just like, well, wait a minute. I mean, the character is French Canadian, but I really don't speak French. And this guy said, I mean, that it just affected him, because he had never seen a truly a French character in Star Trek before. And it affected him. And I've also had people, my character in Potemkin now in Deimos is Welsh. And I worked on a British accent for a long time for that character. And I've had people actually think that I'm from London, who have only seen me on video. And that inclusiveness and representation is important to them. And these are the stories that we're telling. It's just like Larry's story when he had his girlfriend who was so affected by Tracy's performance. We have no idea how many lives we're touching when we do this. It's special and it's rare. And the people who are involved in this, who give us people like me the opportunity to be involved in it, are one in a million. And that's why we all count ourselves so very fortunate to have had the opportunity to work on the sets that are now in your care and custody, and to know the people that we've known. We've all been very fortunate.
Victoria just said something that I really appreciated. She said, our show. And you don't know how good I feel about you saying that and how much I appreciate it. Gary and I go out of our way to make everybody feel included and make everybody feel like it's their show. It's not mine and Gary's show. It's everybody's show that works on it. So thank you for that.
That's what I was saying. I love the collaborative nature that we have on set. You know, everybody has a voice. Everybody has an opinion. We listen to everything and we appreciate the input. And it's us who are honored to have you, Victoria, you, Larry, you, Dan, Joan and John and Thomas. And I could go on and on and on. The people that just come in and they've helped us weave this fabric that we call Dreadnought Dominion. It's just not Randy and I. So when we come and we give the talents that we have, you know, me costuming and props and Randy's storytelling, we're all a collaborative nature. We all put our input in. And if you're just an extra that comes on and just walks down the corridor, you know, we've had scenes where we've had people walk down the corridor and I was giddy because it looks like Star Trek when these people are walking down there doing their various tasks. So everybody, Randy and Victoria, you're absolutely right. This is our show. Everybody from the showrunners to the extras to the stagehands to Royal, who opens and closes those doors, and to the man himself, Ray, who makes it possible and gives us a playground to come down. I really need to give Ray a hand because I just can't say how thankful enough that you have this for us to be able to use.
Well, thank you, Gary. And your remarks are all well said and well appreciated. I just want to read something that someone wrote while you were talking, Victoria, and telling your memory, okay? Kenneth, do you know Kenneth Thompson? Kenneth wrote and said, I'm just going to read it the way he wrote it. And he said, I saw her at a con once, asked her a question, and she came right up to me in the audience to talk face to face. Very cool, such a lovely person.
Oh, thank you.
So I want to thank you guys for being here. This I hope I've given you a little bit of a forum to, you know, be together and talk to people. I want to let you guys know, plus those folks who are listening, and I'm working out the details, but, you know, we've been closed. We talked about it earlier with COVID and everything. We've been closed since, I guess, April 1st. We were going to do a fan film for the studio, and we had to cancel that. So we've been closed since April 1st. I have had on the calendar since probably March that October 23rd and 24th was going to be our next, what I call Falloween, which is our fan appreciation Halloween party. And I'm going to have it. We're going to have some, you know, to have some rules to follow. So we're not going to let too many people in the studio. People will probably need to sign up for a particular time to come on through. Vic has already said he's going to be there to give the walkthroughs. And we want to give you folks who want to come and see us an opportunity to do it again if you've been there, or for the first time if you've never been able to be there. But keep your eyes open, and we are going to do our Halloween in October. So I just want everybody to know that. So I want to thank you all. Gary, thank you very much for being here.
It was Andy? An honor. Thank you so much. Very, very quick thing. If anybody goes to our YouTube channel and watches our shows, please subscribe. Please, please, please. We're at 862. Once we get 1,000 subscribers, we get all kinds of new things we can do. So please, that's all.
Bye. Well, you've kind of reminded me to have one of you say, how can people find you?
Well, we've got
how can people find you?
Yeah, we've got our website, you know, www.dominionmedia.us. And then we are on Facebook. You just search Dreadnought Dominion and all our pages will pop up. And then Randy's YouTube channel.
So you can search Dreadnought Dominion, or you can search David Wrenn.
Excellent. Excellent. So thank you, Gary. Thank you, Randy. Appreciate it. Thank you, Victoria. Thank you, Dan.
Help. Neutral Zone Studios. Help.
Help. Help. Please. And Larry Fleming. Larry Fleming, I want to just say one thing about, and there's a couple of guys that I see all the time, and that's Dan and Larry. And Dan, both of them really can't do enough for the studio. You know, they love it. They live it. I've called on Dan and Larry to go far beyond, you know, probably what they thought they would do or want to do. But they're always there. They're always ready to jump in, whether it's in front of the camera, whether it's behind the camera, whether it's wearing a dress. It doesn't really matter, but those guys, or even the scene I remember from Dreadnought is the scene of you, Dan, climbing into the Jeffries tube with those red lights going and whatever. I thought that was just well filmed, well planned. And that's why the studio's there. If you guys want to make your own fan film, it's easy to do. You can go to, again, to the website, neutralzonestudios.com. There's a section on make your own fan film. Check it out. My contact information is there. I really try to get back to people as quickly and as often as I can. But to you guys who are here, I want to thank you for the work you've done, for keeping Star Trek alive, albeit Dreadnought Dominion or not, okay, you're keeping Star Trek alive, and to a lot of people, that's very meaningful. So thank you, guys. I really appreciate it, and I guess we are, because we're having technical difficulties, I'm probably just going to sign off tonight. So thank you, guys. Live long and prosper.
Live long and prosper.
And we'll see you guys again. We'll see you guys.
I did not wear the dress.
No,
I think you could look up on Google Larry Fleming in a dress and you'll find it. So
no comment.
So hopefully we'll see you guys soon. And if you'd like to, maybe we could do this again sometime. Thank you, guys. And good night, everybody. Thanks. So now we just have to figure out how to stop Facebook, right?